So I'm actually reminded of two different things. One from the life of St. Anselm, one actually from one of his letters. The same problem with not being sure whether you're going to make it through the week came up in Benedictine monasteries constantly. And a lot of the monks were very worried about this. And they would say, I think we're going to starve, because they were dependent on donations. And actually, they were centers of distribution to the local communities. And there's a chapter about this in St. Anselm's life, and says that he always said, God will provide. And it always turned out okay, and they never knew quite how it turned out that way. And the way that the biographer talked about it, he said, we never starved, and we never had so much that we could actually feel secure. So there's that. And then I'm reminded of another thing with the notion that when person A helps person B, person A benefits as a result. Anselm says something like that in terms of Christian love, charity. He says that the one who loves is actually coming out the better on the deal. That, of course, they don't lose their love, which they have, and that's a good thing to have. And the other person gets the benefits. And they may be changed in the process. Love can be transformative, service can be transformative. But it's the person who's actually doing it who is probably most transformed in the process. So, at FSU, like Peter said, we have the Center for Community Justice and Service Learning. And I'm going to skip over some of this since Peter gave the background. Service learning is one of the strategies that we've been incorporating to improve our curriculum and provide better educational outcomes for our students. And we have some strategic priorities that were established. Service learning fits in very closely with those. One is we have a real problem with retention and graduation rates, as do a lot of minority schools and lower tier schools. Service learning, if it can engage the students, should help us with that. We also have a strategic priority of economic transformation of the Fayetteville area. So the Center for Community Justice and Service Learning is part of that. And then collaborations and partnerships with other entities, including those within the local area and those more globally. Service learning has the potential for tying us in with that. So FSU has been supportive of that. And we have this center. I'm going to actually just hit on a few issues with this. One is that they offer us a lot of resources as faculty members. They have some teaching fellowships. I received one of those in order to design a service learning critical thinking class. And they help us out. They do a lot of the paperwork for us. They sometimes tie us in with the service organizations. So they're a great resource. I don't think we could do much of our service learning without having that center there to help us. Now, my experience of service learning at FSU has been that it's fairly easy for some disciplines to tie in with it. If you're doing criminal justice and you have upper level students who already have some high developed skills and are committed, some classes are very adaptive to service learning pretty easily. And these are the sort of things that we have them do. We have students use the skills they've already learned, or they use the service opportunities to provide raw material for reflection, where they would apply the course skills, or they're doing research that raises awareness. So for some disciplines, that works very well. For critical thinking, which is an entry-level class for us and is a required class, every student at FSU has to take it. And many of them don't take it seriously. We have a DFW rate, so that's students getting Ds, Fs, or withdrawing. Our rate is 38%. So at any given time, one out of three students in my class is a repeat person. Some of them take it 3-4 times before they actually pass. It's a difficult class, in part because it's dealing with fundamental skills that these students need to have, and they're not getting in K-12. And they're not even aware that they have a deficit. I'm dealing with incoming freshmen. Students already don't have the critical thinking skills that they need, in part just to be able to recognize that they need critical thinking skills. A lot of content has to be taught. We have 18 different student learning outcomes built into our syllabi that we have to meet, ranging from being able to distinguish premises and conclusions in arguments, all the way through to being able to evaluate statistical information. I can't assume for any of the students that are coming into my classes that they possess basic writing or research skills, and often I have to teach some of those in the class to them. I also can't presume that the students are all that aware of what it means to be a student. And this is an issue that we have not only at FSU, but in many of the institutions where we're taking in first-generation students, where we're not, getting the students who have come from the best educational backgrounds, we're not getting the students who score very highly. A lot of them have trouble with things like showing up on time or completing assignments as they're assigned. Some of them will hand in half an assignment and have a sort of blank look on their face when you tell them this really isn't enough. So we have to train them actually in what it means to be a student. So they're starting out a bit behind. Those are challenges for any type of course, and if we're going to try to put service learning into it, well, now that introduces other challenges. Service learning requires that you devote some class time to talking about service learning and following up with the assignments and, saying, are you sure you're on track? And, deciding what your outcomes for these students are going to be, and then having them do their presentations, poster sessions, any of those sorts of things. So that time has to come from somewhere. We also have to provide some ways for the students to practice the skills and dispositions of critical thinking in their service learning reflection. That's not as easy as, say, applying, something from an upper-level criminal justice course or a sociology course. We have to provide alternate sets of graded assignments and student products. There has to also be some opt-out, because if the students don't want to be in that class and they get stuck in it, and they don't want to do service, but they needed that time slot, we have to be able to satisfy them. That's a requirement of the university. I also think that the class, in order to work, needs some sort of overarching theme. Last time I tried it, I did it trying to work with the Cumberland County Council on Older Adults, dealing with retired baby boomers and volunteers. It didn't work very well. Some of the aspects of it worked quite well, some of them didn't. And actually, in that case, one of the reasons, I said this at lunch, one of the reasons why I wanted to do this in the first place is the first time I did service learning with critical thinking, it was, I wouldn't say a success. I wouldn't even say a mixed success. There were some good points about it. Some of the better students did some great work. But for the most part, it didn't come off as a service learning course. So given the opportunity to do it again, I wanted to do it. So I came back to the center, for a fellowship, and I'm going to try to do it this time. And when I was talking with people at the college about all these different food issues, I realized that I might have something here which actually could tie in very well with our course objectives. Food awareness and these issues of food insecurity. What do we actually have to do in the class? Why would it fit in well? Well, food awareness by itself, I'm interested in that by itself because I like to eat and I like to cook, and I know a lot of people who do, and we talk about those sorts of things. But food is also something that is very primal. It's not only very primal, very basic, everybody has to eat, everybody cooks food. It also takes us all the way to the heights of culture. So everything in between. Every single civilization that we know of has done something interesting with food, and they've differentiated social roles, or they've invested it with meanings. So food offers us a lot of room for trash. And it's also something that we typically take for granted until we start digging into it. So there's a lot of room for the students to come alive as they realize things. It's also a timely topic, in part because of all the health concerns that are out there in the news, diabetes, for example, all the issues about what's in our foods. There was the trans fat issue a while back. We have questions about the sustainability of our food practices. As we were being taken on tour, one of the things that was remarked on was the need to find new fish, because we like certain fish, so we eat too much of them, and then there's not enough of them to reproduce, so we got to find some other fish. That's a sustainability issue. I don't think most of our students have any inkling of that. But that could be a great issue for them to do some thinking about. Social policy aspects. The Obama administration seems quite interested in food education. So that makes it timely as well. There's a lot of other projects underway nationwide and locally that we can tie in with. So that offers our students a chance to do some lifelong learning. And for me, I envision this as a long-term project where multiple classes, semester after semester, could further this project with tying in critical thinking and food awareness, maybe building off of the relationships or building off of the products that the previous classes did. So, and again, that could be engaging for the students, I think, as well. I also think this could be a good, this is really the bottom line. It's not awesome. The only way in which this could possibly work for my class would be if it satisfies learning objectives. Or learning outcomes, rather. Because you can do all the service you like, but unless you actually have student learning outcomes that are being satisfied by it, it really doesn't have much place in your class. If you're teaching a critical thinking class, these are the sorts of things that we have to teach. Argument is at the very center critical thinking. So if the students have a great time and learn a lot about food, but they come out of my class and they can't identify premises and conclusions, I may have done service learning, but I failed. So the class has to have these sorts of things, and I think that all of these, from identifying claims, issues, and topics, to distinguishing arguments from explanations, all the way down to making evidence-based arguments, all of that fits in very well with food awareness. Because people are constantly making claims daily about what's going to be healthy for us, what's going to kill us, what liabilities we're going to have when obese people wind up with these problems, why the kids are not eating what they need to eat, all these sorts of things. People are making claims, and they're competing with each other. So this seems to be a very almost tailor-made set of issues. So I'm thinking about my service and learning activities. What I'm looking at right now is having some direct service. We have local soup kitchens, especially the Salvation Army, which also actually has a garden in Fayetteville that they might be able to work in. I'm looking at some other local providers and projects, so that's one avenue. I have to provide several different avenues for these students. Assign them all to one single project because, again, we're dealing with students who have a lot of demands on their time, don't have transportation for the most part, and need to be engaged. With indirect service, Rodney O'Neill, who's our VISTA volunteer at the center, we've had him for 2 years, we've been very lucky. He's actually carrying out research on food insecurity within the local area right around Fayetteville State University. Fayetteville State University is in the same sort of situation that a lot of small universities are. The local area is pretty run down, a lot of poverty. This has made it possible for FSU to buy up properties here and there when they have extra money. And it's a question now of investing back into the local community and helping out. So Rodney's going to be carrying that out. He said he can take as many students as I can throw at him. So that's another avenue. Social action research, I've been looking at a few ideas. I've actually gotten some more ideas of it as I've been sitting here listening to the different panelists talk about what I might have the students who don't want to do direct service or indirect service do. I'm also looking for more ideas. And these are the questions that I want to pose to all the service learning experts. The reason I came here was actually to get advice about my class, how to make this work better. So what other kinds of projects could fit in with or complement what I've got here so far? That's one thing. I'm looking at reflection projects. I've got some things in mind, but I'd also like to hear any suggestions that you guys have for reflection projects. What do you think my students need to support? I've got some ideas about what I need to do as a professor of critical thinking, providing them schemas for arguments, you know, things like that. But maybe there's some other things that I've overlooked that these students need for support in order to make this work. And then this is another one, how to produce a commitment on these students' part to something bigger than themselves, to their classmates, to the class as a unit. This is something we have a lot of trouble with at FSU. Students are often very individualized. And it's difficult, it's very difficult actually to get the good students, that talented 10, to want to invest in the rest of the students. I want to get them on board, but I also want to produce some sort of sense of solidarity. So that's an issue. And then I want this to be a continuing project, so if you have ideas about where this could go afterwards, other things that might be incorporated that have to do with food awareness or scarcity and would satisfy these core requirements that I have for my class, dealing with arguments, claims, information sources, I'm all ears. So that's it for my presentation. Yeah.
Can you just tell me a little bit about the demographics of your students?
Peter can probably tell you more. I can tell you that we're about 70% African American, about 15% white, and then the rest is a mix of different things. Mostly lower middle class, you know, lower class to some middle class. Mostly first generation.
It's changed over the years. There was a time when, I think it was about 50, when I came to Fayetteville State in 75, about 60% African American.
Yeah.
And 40% almost all of that was, that other 40% is Caucasian.
Yeah.
We have increased our Native American population, our Asian American population. We are right next to Fort Bragg, and so we do draw some from Fort Bragg, although
right,
not as much as we did back in 75. the reasons for that are complicated.
There is one other thing, too. There's two female students for every male student.
From where?
It's 66% female student body. So there's a huge gender imbalance. Mm-hmm. And actually, we have a lot of trouble retaining the male students over time.
Yeah, we even have an initiative that's been going on for
several. For high school students, I mean, one of the reasons that kids drop out is because they expect that they're going to fail anyways.
Yeah.
And so is that the case in the college system? I can't imagine it's any different.
You know,
maybe that freshman year they get their first student loan, spend it all, and get the grade.
A lot of them don't expect they're going to fail. They show up to the class, and their expectation is by showing up and handing in some work some of the time. Again, I'm not saying this about all of our students. We have a small group that are always going to be high performers. And then we have sort of a mid-range group that actually do, you know, work hard. But then we have a lot of students who think that just by showing up when they feel like it, handing in what they feel like handing in when they feel like it, they will squeak by with a D. And that's okay for them. And then they find out that no, they got out of themselves at 30 or 20 in the class and they get an F. And then they're very surprised. And actually, we spend a lot of time in the class going through practical reasoning. Hey, if you want to get the good job, what do you have to do? You have to get the degree. And if you want to get the degree, what do you have to do? It means that reasoning. But again, it's this classic problem with a disengaged student. Who actually hears that lecture? Who actually participates in it? The ones that are already somewhat engaged, the ones who are disengaged and passive, they just sit there and it doesn't make any effect. And they'll be sitting there nodding. And by the way, this is not a exclusively African-American student thing. This is across the board. I've taught at lower tier institutions of a lot of different sorts, and I've seen this sort of thing. The only place I didn't see it was when I was teaching in a maximum security prison, where most of the prisoners had gotten their GEDs, but they were almost all over 30. I think there's a whole generation of lower tier students who are very used to passive attitudes towards education and just being sort of pushed through that are hitting our universities.
They also hear those messages. I mean, and there's nothing like the media to portray the public school system as it actually is. And they see that and they believe it. And I think the way to get to young people is to get them to evaluate their own, the social injustices that they're confronted with. Have them go back into the high schools and evaluate public education and what should it be? What ought it be?
There's that, but they also have to. One thing that's also missing is personal responsibility. I don't think that there has to be this opposition between sort of collective responsibility and personal responsibility. For our students, it's when they actually say, oh yeah, this is my education, these are my loans I'm taking out. Man, I better get my act together. I've already got through withdrawals, now I gotta buckle down. And a lot of them will do that later on. The other thing is too, like I said, FSU has been putting a lot of efforts into various pedagogical practices. And we can get some of the, you can never get all the students to engage. You can shave off, with that proportion of disengaged students, you can shave off a proportion of them. You can get them involved. So we do service learning, maybe 10% of our students are more engaged. Well, that's probably good. We're not gonna get everybody. And then we can supplement that with inquiry-guided learning, another 10%. We supplement that with collegiate learning assessment, performance tests, which students turn out to like quite a bit, because it's sort of case study method, another 10%. We're still going to have some that, simply aren't going to make it. But we can reduce the amount of disengaged students over time, I hope.
But the learning objectives that you have for critical thinking, another thing is that it's my experience in listening to the students that I've had in just literacy and numeracy types of classes, which are very base education, kids catching up from, second, third grade reading and math level skills, but they're not incapable of very strong critical thinking skills. They can orally argue very well. Certain aspects of their education have not been well informed or framed.
But here's the problem. When we look at what employers want, because these kids have to go, they have to have jobs. That's the bottom line. Employers aren't very interested in their oral skills. Employers are constantly saying, what are the two things that employers say to most? Critical thinking and written communication. If they don't have those, there's Indian and Chinese students out there who they can hire instead. Or students who, went to upper tier schools in the United States. They can hire them instead of our students. Our students have to be able to not just capitalize on what they're strong in, but also make up for those deficits. They're starting out behind. So,
saying the responsibility, the concept that they might
problem solving and critical thinking are related.
Right.
But problem solving is, for the most part, higher order skills. You need the critical thinking skills. You have to scaffold those. You have to build on those. And what we do in the critical thinking class culminates in problem solving. But first, they actually have to figure out, you know, here's a claim. Is there actually a claim here? Or is this a question? And then some of the students don't do that. Then they have to be able to figure out, you know, how the claims fit in with each other. This is very, very low-order stuff that we take for granted. But we have to teach our students this because they don't have that. Then they can ascend to problem solving. That's where we're going. But you can't do the, you know, it's sort of like wanting to play the people who buy a guitar. I'm going to play, pick whatever band you like. No, first you have to do a lot of scales. And it's kind of boring, but if you don't do it, then you can't do the guitar solos. You know, you have to learn chords, and you have to memorize them, and you have to go through them. This is foundational knowledge stuff. And then you can start to do the fun stuff.
They'll have students come in and plant, right? And then they have students come back and harvest. And then they have students come back again and cook.
Different students or the same students?
Same students. Right. So that they get this idea, like, I'm putting this into the ground, I'm putting this out, you know, take this out from the ground, now I'm making this and they cook meals for their families.
Yeah.
And with what Pat Tavira is saying about keeping these journals, right, of whatever restaurant ops class is
yeah.
for, would it be something where you could have, and I'm thinking it's minded, right? You have one class is for claim. Like these are the issues that are indigenous to the Fayetteville area. This is why these things aren't readily found in your supermarkets.
Yeah.
Or, you know, yes, Kroger's over here in this zip code charges 2 cents more than in this zip code where really the more affluent people live.
Yeah.
There's all these sort of kind of collective food scarcity statements that are made. Some of them are myths, some of them
Yeah, those are things that we're going to actually talk
about. So if you have that class, look at it, and then you take something from that list, right? Like maybe this is something that's indigenous to this area. Would you be able to have one group of students in fall semester, you know, find a place to do a community farm? The next group in spring semester publicizes the farm and gets local CSA. The next group in the fall semester plants, you know, spring semester harvests. Next fall semester cooks. And meanwhile, these people who have gone through are being invited to participate, and you're building sort of a better community of scholarship while also building on one simple idea that doesn't have to be accomplished in a whole term. It allows them to sort of explore argument, explore claims, you know, do some of that foundational stuff with the understanding that they're giving a legacy. Because I think when you're talking about dropouts or anything, there's this idea that you're alone in the universe, you know?
Yeah.
And that there is no continuity. What you're doing now just place doing this, and, you know, money and time and effort. You know, school classes that start at 4 in the morning and go until 10 o'clock at night and then club activities after, that's because we've tapped their passion.
Yeah.
So we have the best possible scenario here. If you're dealing with all of these extraneous variables, maybe it is to find passion in the idea that they're not simply isolated classes that have no bearing to one another, or that they are indeed responsible to someone larger than themselves, and it might be the class who comes in next time. You know, you can track it on a blog, you can build a site, you can have, you know, photo records, do all these different things,
yeah.
But then you're building an archive. And maybe you'd see what we saw with our garbage classes here, where once they started photographing their work, the next class came in and wanted to do something bigger, better, faster, you know,
right.
More rock star, whatever. And it just keeps growing, you know, and so we've got students wanting to do sous vide garbage. I mean, that's like, you know, it's a cutting edge technology in the culinary world, and these are students who aren't even, you know, they haven't even gone out on their working extern. They haven't had their experiential moment.
Yeah.
So maybe something like that would work at FSU. I don't know, but it seems with one dedicated guy, you know, the Rodney situation, right? You should be able to have somebody then who could maintain an archive or a source to keep them engaged through VISTA, through AmeriCorps.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's starting very, very small.
Well, we're going to be doing that small stuff in the class because we're taking claims made about food as the content for practicing argument, you know, analysis, distinguishing argument from explanation, all these sorts of basic skills.
So maybe you have to hand that data, you know, to the next class.
Sure. Oh yeah, I intend to. That keeps me from actually having to make up completely new course, you know, materials every single semester. That's actually time saving. And then you can have the same class look at the previous student work with it, which is what I do in my other classes. With Rodney's project on food insecurity, he is starting locally and then he's going to expand. One issue that does come up is transportation for our students. These are freshmen, they don't have cars. Fayetteville has a very poor public transportation system. So.
But what about what Peter was saying? I mean, we said Burgess at the corner. I mean, your office is in Burgess, right? Couldn't there be some lot between the end of that block and FSU where somebody's got a patch that they'd be willing to...
Actually, that is something that we're working on. The School of Business is trying to get a community garden going. And when that gets going, then I can have my students work in with them.
Yeah.
But this is something that I explored at the center. And we thought it might be up by next semester, but it's not going to be. So that would be for next year. But yeah, these are all good continuity ideas. Rodney's research is going to continue. So I can have students continue along with him. Provided that, of course, they can get to where he's going to expand the research to. Right now, it's just going to be in the Fayetteville area. It's just walking distance. So that's not an issue. All right. Thank you very much.
Yeah.